We're given the function f of x equals x times the square root of the quantity x squared plus 4 on the closed interval from negative 4 to 7. We first want to determine the open intervals where the function is concave up or concave down. Then we'll determine any points of inflection and then determine the absolute extrema. So to determine where a function is concave up or concave down, we'll first determine where the second derivative is equal to 0 or undefined. And then based upon those values, we'll divide the given interval into subintervals and test the sign of the second derivative in each subinterval. Where the second derivative is positive, the function is concave up, and where the second derivative is negative, the function is concave down. So to find the second derivative, we'll begin by finding the first derivative. But before we begin, we want to rewrite the given function using rational exponents. So the given function f of x is equal to x times the quantity x squared plus 4 to the 1/2 power. Taking the square root of a quantity is equivalent to raising it to the 1/2 power. Notice in this form, we'll have to apply the product rule in order to find the first derivative. So f prime of x is going to be equal to the first function x times the derivative of the second function, which would be the derivative of the quantity x squared plus 4 to the 1/2 power, plus the second function, which is x squared plus 4 to the 1/2, times the derivative of the first function, which is just x. So now we'll find the derivative here and the derivative here. So f prime of x is equal to x times, to find this derivative, we'll have to apply the extended power rule, which includes the chain rule where the inner function u would be equal to x squared plus 4. So we'd have 1/2 times the quantity x squared plus 4 to the 1/2 minus 1, or negative 1/2, times the derivative of x squared plus 4, which would be 2x. And then we have plus just the quantity x squared plus 4 to the 1/2, because the derivative of x would be 1. Let's go ahead and simplify this product here. Notice this 2 and this 2 simplify to 1. And because this is a negative exponent, we'll move it to the denominator. So this would be equal to x squared divided by the quantity x squared plus 4 to the 1/2. And then plus, let's write this as the quantity x squared plus 4 to the 1/2 over 1. So if we want to add these two fractions, we'd have to obtain a common denominator, which would be the quantity x squared plus 4 to the 1/2. So let's go ahead and multiply this fraction here by x squared plus 4 to the 1/2 over x squared plus 4 to the 1/2. Notice when we do this, we have our common denominator, which is the quantity x squared plus 4 to the 1/2. Looking at the numerator now, we have x squared plus, here when we multiply, we'd add the exponents. 1/2 plus 1/2 is 1. So this product here would just be the quantity x squared plus 4. Let's continue on the next slide. Combining like terms in the numerator, we would have 2x squared plus 4 divided by x squared plus 4 to the 1/2. So to find the second derivative, we'll have to find the derivative of the first derivative. And notice here we'll have to apply the quotient rule given here below. So f double prime of x would be equal to, beginning with the denominator, we'd have the denominator squared. So we'd have the quantity x squared plus 4 to the 1/2 squared. Notice how this will simplify nicely. Then our numerator is going to be the denominator times the derivative of the numerator, which would be the derivative of 2x squared plus 4 minus the numerator times the derivative of the denominator. Let's move this denominator toward the middle. So the second derivative will be equal to, the denominator is just going to be x squared plus 4 to the first. So we'll have x squared plus 4 to the 1/2 times the derivative of 2x squared plus 4, that's going to be 4x, and then minus the quantity 2x squared plus 4 times the derivative of the quantity x squared plus 4 to the 1/2, that's going to be 1/2 times the quantity x squared plus 4 to the negative 1 half times the derivative of x squared plus 4, that's 2x. So simplifying here, the 2 and the 2 simplify out. So our second derivative, let's focus on the numerator. Here we'd have 4x times the quantity x squared plus 4 to the 1 half. And then here we're going to have minus, the numerator is going to be x times 2x squared plus 4. Here we have a negative exponent, so we'll move this down to the denominator, which would be x squared plus 4 to the positive 1 half. Now to subtract these fractions in the numerator, we'd have to again obtain a common denominator, which would be the quantity x plus 4 to the 1 half. So now in this case, we'll multiply this first fraction by x squared plus 4 to the 1 half over x squared plus 4 to the 1 half. Let's go ahead and finish this on the next slide. Now looking at the numerator, notice how we do have a common denominator of the quantity x squared plus 4 to the 1 half. And then in the numerator, notice how here we have the same base, so we add the exponents. So we'd have 4x times the quantity x squared plus 4 to the first, or just 4x times the quantity x squared plus 4, and then minus x times the quantity 2x squared plus 4. Now for the next step, instead of dividing by the quantity x squared plus 4, we're going to multiply by the reciprocal, and we'll also simplify this numerator. Notice we'd have 4x cubed plus 16x, and then minus 2x cubed minus 4x. So we can write this as f double prime of x is equal to, again, the fraction up on top would be the denominator of x squared plus 4 to the 1 half. The numerator is going to be, here we have 4x cubed minus 2x cubed, that's 2x cubed. And then we have plus 16x minus 4x, that's plus 12x. And now instead of dividing by the quantity x squared plus 4, we'll multiply by the reciprocal of 1 over the quantity x squared plus 4. Again, this would be to the first power. So finally, our second derivative function is equal to 2x to the third plus 12x divided by the quantity x squared plus 4 to the 1 half plus 1, or 3 halves power. So now to determine the concavity, we want to begin by determining where the second derivative is equal to 0 or undefined. Notice because we have a base of x squared plus 4 in the denominator, this would never be 0, so we'll never have division by 0. So this fraction is going to be 0 when the numerator is equal to 0. So if we set the numerator equal to 0, notice how we would have 2x to the third plus 12x equals 0. Which would factor? We can factor out 2x, leaving us with the quantity x squared plus 6 equals 0. So either 2x equals 0 or x squared plus 6 equals 0. Well, x squared plus 6 equals 0 will not give us any real solutions, but 2x equals 0, if we divide both sides by 2, notice how x equals 0. So this is the only value where the second derivative is going to be equal to 0. So now we'll divide the interval from negative 4 to 7 using the value of x equals 0. And then we'll test the sign of the second derivative in each of those intervals. Let's do this on the next slide. So because the second derivative was equal to 0 when x equals 0, we'll divide the interval from negative 4 to 7into the open interval from negative 4 to 0 and the open interval from 0 to 7. And now we'll test the sign of the second derivative in each of these intervals. So let's go ahead and use the test value of x equals negative 1 in this first interval. F double prime of negative 1 would be equal to, this would be negative 2 plus negative 12, that's negative 14, divided by the quantity negative 1 squared plus 4 to the 3 halves power. Notice how this quotient would be negative or less than 0, which means the second derivative is negative over this entire interval, and therefore the function is concave down on this open interval. And now for the second interval, let's test x equals 1. So for f double prime of 1, notice how we'd have 2 plus 12, that's positive 14, divided by the quantity 1 squared plus 4 to the 3 halves power. This quotient would be positive or greater than 0, and therefore the second derivative is positive over this entire interval, and therefore the function is concave up on this entire interval. And notice how the function changes concavity at x equals 0, which means we have a point of inflection at x equals 0. Again, the function changes from concave down to concave up at x equals 0. So for the next question, when we're asked to find the point of inflection, we know the x coordinate has to be 0. So to find the y coordinate of the point of inflection, we substitute x equals 0 back into the original function. Remember, the point of inflection is the point on the function, so we'll have to find f of 0 to find the y coordinate. So that would give us 0 times the square root of 0 squared plus 4. Well, that's going to be 0 times the square root of 4, or 0 times 2, which of course is 0. So the point of inflection is at the origin, or the point 0, 0. And then finally, the last question was to find the absolute extrema, which means find the absolute maximum and absolute minimum. To do this, we want to evaluate the function at the endpoints and at any critical numbers which occur where the first derivative is equal to 0 or undefined. But if we go back and take a look at our first derivative, here we're never going to have division by 0, so it'll never be undefined because x squared plus 4 will never be 0. And also x squared plus 4, the numerator, will never be 0. And therefore the first derivative is never 0 or undefined, so there are no critical numbers. So to find the absolute extrema, we'll evaluate the function at just the endpoints. To save some time, I paused the video and did some work here. Notice here I found f of negative 4, which was equal to negative 8 square root of 5, and f of 7 was equal to 7 square root of 53. So the smallest value here, which is negative 8 square root of 5, is the absolute minimum, and positive 7 square root of 53 would be the absolute maximum. And therefore we can say the absolute minimum is negative 8 square root of 5, which is approximately negative 17.89 at x equals negative 4, and the absolute maximum is 7 square root of 53, which is approximately 50.96 at x equals 7. Let's look at our results on the graph. First, talking about the concavity, notice how the function is concave down on the open interval from negative 4 to 0, as we see here. And then the function is concave up on the open interval from 0 to 7 here. And because the function changes concavity at the origin here, notice how the point of inflection is the point 0, 0. And then finally, on the close interval, notice how the smallest value is approximately negative 17.89 at negative 4, and the maximum function value is approximately 50.96 at x equals 7. I hope you found this helpful.